Thank you. have one that is for a phone, yeah. Phones are getting bigger and bigger. You know, there's that Samsung thing. Yeah, that's that Samsung
Would you do me a favor? Would you take out your phone and would you text the word welcome to 803-590-1975? And maybe you're visiting with us online. You can text the word hello to that same number, 803-590-1975. So that's how you can get connected with us. To stay connected, you would text the word Luke to that same number, 803-590-1975. And then you know some of the things that we have going on here. Like this evening, we're going to be going out. We won't be gathering here for our time of prayer. We're going to be gathering over at the family courthouse, right in front of the family courthouse. Representative Norman is helping to lead a time of prayer there, and where we're going to have Speak Life. And so that'll be with the Palmetto Women's Center and some other folks that'll be out. But we want to be out there and represent EC Baptist Church and, most importantly, represent our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ and say, we stand for life, and we want to support that. But we also want to say that we stand for grace. And so we want to be very clear that we are supporters of grace and of life. And so we want to represent our Lord and Savior well. And maybe you're planning on joining us out there and you've got a child and you're like, well, I need to have something to do with my child during that time. Well, we got something for you. Kids on Mission this evening will begin at 4:45 and we'll end at 6:15. So that'll give you an opportunity to be able to drop your child off here. And then you'll be able to carry yourselves back over there, and you'll be able to come back in time to pick up your child at 6:15. So hope to see you then. And as we go and we speak life this evening, and our kids get to come, what it means to be on mission for our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And as we're reflecting what it means to be on mission for Him, we want to think about this time and this month is what it means to be celebrate the Reformation. So this was the time that helped bring us to where we are today with numerous Protestant denominations and not just one denomination actually encouraging people to buy forgiveness of sin, because we don't have that. You don't buy forgiveness of sin. It's all been paid. Jesus paid it all. Unfortunately, you could even go to some websites. You go to the Vatican website right now and you could pay for penance. And that is just not true. And so we want to stand for that which is true. And so I invite the Buchanans to come as we read and focus on grace this morning.
Grace. Please stand as we read together Ephesians 2, 8 through 9. For by grace you have been saved through faith, and this is not your own doing. It is the gift of God, not a result of works, so that no one may boast.
Hey, sometimes as Christians, we forget how powerful and fundamental this passage is to us. There's absolutely nothing that we can do to earn salvation. It is a gift of God. God gives us this gift because he loves us. The God of all creation loves us. And we bring glory to him because of his gift also gives us his Holy Spirit, who does good works through us for the glory of God. Thank you.
Thank you. Let's remain standing as we sing the song of grace, because we're focused on grace, but sing "This Is Amazing Grace."
The King of Glory, the King of
our God.
battery in. Isn't it good to know that our God doesn't run on 9-volt batteries? God runs on eternal power.
It doesn't need a battery. God is awesome in power, higher than any other. So we've come to worship Him today. We've come to pray. We've come to recognize that there are missionaries and their children who are still captive in Haiti. They're wanting, I think it's $17 million ransom, $1 million for each person there. The aid organization, Christian Aid Ministries out of Ohio, has asked that the church pray. You don't have any idea that those families were just there on a mission trip. We're going to Puerto Rico in a couple of months, and we don't know. Somebody could come hijack the bus, take those who were there off to some unknown location and demand ransom. It's worth it. The gospel's worth it. Those missionaries and those children might lose their lives, but God's worth it. So let's pray today that out of tragedy could be hope restored. You know, the people of Haiti, many of them just shut down Port-au-Prince last week. They said, you know what, if you're going to do that to those folks who came to help us, we're just going to shut down the city. And they went out in the streets and they closed the shops so you couldn't go buy anything. Some of the taxi drivers that tried to you know, keep doing their work, they were barricaded with tire fires in the middle of the main streets in Port-au-Prince. And Port-au-Prince said, we're tired of this. We're not going to have this anymore. There's evil in the world, but our God has overcome the evil in the world. The cross was a very vile place, and Christ took our place on that cross so that we might have life. And so we can sing, our God is greater, our God is higher, our God is stronger. So would you pray with me, church family, as we pray for those who are captive, not just in Haiti. I read about the thousands that are still in Afghanistan that want to get out now. Many believers who are ready to say, we can't take this anymore. Many others around the world who are captive for Christ. And none of them have said that Christ isn't worth it. Father, I thank you that you are a God who is stronger and higher. Lord, we recognize today, as we've sung those words with our lips, that we may not fully comprehend all that that really means. Father, today there are brothers and sisters who are literally being held captive for ransom. I pray that today that they would know the church, those who believe in Jesus Christ, the church universal around the world is praying for their release. But more than that, God, we pray that they would continue to show your love to their captors, so that those captors might see that what those missionaries came to do wasn't just build an orphanage in their community. It wasn't just to come do nice things to get a pat on the back when they got home from their organization in Ohio. It was to make the love of Christ known in Haiti. God, your love for those captors is the same as your love for me. It's only by your grace that my heart of stone has been replaced with a heart of flesh. And you can do the same for those captors as well. And should every one of those missionaries and their children die at the hands of these captors, their lives would not have been lived in vain, because they sought to make you supreme in their lives. Peter had to count the cost when you asked him to follow you. you call us to do the same. Do we really believe? Are we willing to lose our life for you? Well, it's easy to say that in an air-conditioned building, comfortable chairs, nice people, friends around us. It's easy to say that. Prepare us, Father, whether you call us to the other side of the planet, or whether you call us to go see our neighbor and tell them about the hope of Christ. Would you prepare our hearts? Put our faith into action, because faith without works is dead. I pray for brothers and sisters in Afghanistan who are persecuted for their faith. For those underground railroads that are trying to rescue people over overland routes, I pray that you might show them favor. Lord, that some of the neighboring countries, Tajikistan and others, would open their borders so that refugees could escape. Father, I thank you that we can come and stand on the steps of the York County Family Courthouse tonight, and we can declare that we stand up for life, all of life, womb to tomb. Father, I thank you for the work of restoration that you brought to David Hubbard's life. I ask that you continue to show your favor, Randy Fields. I thank you for that. For Grant Hoffman today, Lord, that you continue to bring restoration. Chris Culbertson, God, thank you for the healing you're bringing in his life. To the Youngblood family, God, continue to move. Other needs in our church family, God, and beyond, I pray that you would answer in such a way that you get the glory. That eyes might be opened, that darkness would be removed, that light would fill the space. The light of the glory of Jesus Christ would shine through. Pray for other churches in our community who are struggling today. Ask that you might draw near to them. For the sake of the gospel, we pray these things in the name of Christ. Amen. Well, we've been walking through the Joseph narratives, book of Genesis, so you can go ahead and turn with me, if you would, to Genesis chapter 42. We've been working our way through, and what we've seen is God's providential hand over all of the circumstances that are shaping and preparing God's people through suffering and great trial. It wasn't really just to get Joseph to some sort of influential, high-paying governmental job. It wasn't what God's work was all about. It was to conform him into the image of Christ. The same is true for us. Whatever struggle, whatever heartbreak, whatever joy, God is using every experience to shape us like Christ. And so we've watched Joseph move from favored son to prison bars to governor of food distribution in Pharaoh's palace. All the while, completely confident in God's faithful provision. All the while, having no clue how his family back in Canaan was doing or why God would place him in Egypt. Now, all of that's getting ready to change as we get into chapter 42. Look at the last two verses of chapter 41, though. It says, "So when the famine had spread over all the land, Joseph opened all the storehouses and sold to the Egyptians, for the famine was severe in the land of Egypt. Moreover, all the earth came to Egypt to Joseph to buy grain because the famine was severe over all the earth." So this famine that God had revealed through Joseph's dream interpretations were especially coming true in a severe famine, not only in Egypt, but all over the earth, it says. Now, famines actually have a unique place in God's redemptive plan. As the COVID virus swept the globe, the UN warned of potential economic disruption that could result in, quote, famines of biblical proportions. Now, that's an interesting choice of words from a UN official, but they were on to something. Famines are found throughout the biblical narrative, often to signal major change in the lives of its characters. I read a Hebrew professor, Joel Baden, who studies the Hebrew Bible. He says, famine in the Bible is more than a curse. It's a signal of change and a chance for a new beginning. Now, if you were to do a quick Old Testament survey, this not only includes the narratives in the chapter of Genesis, but also considers, when you think of this idea of famine, that all three patriarchs to whom the land of promise was given had to deal with famine. So Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob all had to deal with famine. The book of Ruth, some of you ladies are studying. The book of Ruth opens with a famine that forces Naomi and her family to move to and then from Moab. Israel endured a three-year famine during the time of King David. Jesus even speaks of a famine when it talks about opening the eyes of the prodigal son that moves him to repentance. It was a famine in the land that he started to think, my dad's servants have it better than this. All of these things I want to use to help us see and consider the grace of famine. We typically think of grace as God's favor to those who don't deserve it. God's offer of salvation instead of condemnation to those whom he wills. And it certainly is that. But grace can also be used in the sense of overflowing abundance of goodness and generosity. Paul uses the word grace in this way as he encourages the Corinthian church regarding their giving to help meet the needs of impoverished Christians in Jerusalem. God's grace in the famine is seen in how God abundantly provided for the storehouses in Egypt to be overflowing with grain. God's grace in the famine was also seen in God moving Joseph's brothers to seek relief from a country that had no responsibility to care for its neighbors. But bigger than that, it was setting up an opportunity for the reunification of Joseph's family, Jacob ultimately, his family, where God had strategically placed Joseph in charge to test and bless the family through whom would come the seed of the woman, the Messiah. So God was using a famine to initiate a work of restoration in the patriarchs. And so our narrative opens with the fact that Jacob hears about the opportunity for food relief in Egypt. So let's look. Chapter 42, verse 1 through 5. When Jacob learned that there was grain for sale in Egypt, he said to his sons, "Why do you look at one another?" And he said, "Behold, I've heard that there is grain for sale in Egypt. Go down and buy grain for us there that we may live and not die." So 10 of Joseph's brothers went down to buy grain in Egypt. But Jacob did not send Benjamin, Joseph's brother, with his brothers, for he feared that harm might happen to him. Thus the sons of Israel came to buy among the others who came, for the famine was in the land of Canaan. Now, we're not sure exactly how Jacob heard about food in Egypt, but I don't want us to miss what's missing in those two verses. Maybe you picked up on it as well. There's no mention of seeking the Lord. There's nothing about repentance. Nothing about waiting on the Lord for wisdom and discernment. It's just, ooh, there's grain, I heard, down in Egypt. Go do something about it. And it should lead us to ask ourselves this question. When famine comes, when our trial comes, where do we turn? Do we turn to our own resources, the resources of the world, or do we turn our plans over to the Lord? Famine forces us to choose. Do we really believe what we say we believe about the Lord offering wisdom and provision and care for his children? Because, friends, our actions will declare our answer to that question. The grace in our trial or the grace in the famine is that if we choose to walk our own way and walk contrary to the Lord's plans, guess what? God doesn't abandon us. He already knows our waywardness and will bring us back home if we trust him. Isn't that good, church? That's God's grace to us. That if we went to him when the trial comes, he'll give us the strength and wisdom to how to work through it. But he'll also give us the grace if we, I don't need you, God, I've got this, and walk out on our own path and find ourselves wrecked on the side of the road, there's grace that he'll bring us back. What a God. He shows grace either way. No matter how great our trial, we don't have to fear. Psalm 75:3 reminds us, when the earth totters and all its inhabitants, it is I, the Lord, who keeps steady its pillars. Isn't that amazing? When it feels like your world is just shaking from underneath you, God says, oh no, I've got the pillars of the earth in my hands. I'll steady. Jacob's hearing of the potential for relief from Egypt brought about a scolding to his boys. Did you pick up on it? Hey boys, what are you doing just looking at each other? Get down to Egypt, do something. Don't just stand there staring at each other. That wasn't an exaggeration, though. Things were that dire in the land. Isn't it interesting that the land of promise, the land that was supposed to be flowing with milk and honey, was often described that way, is now out of grain? It seems rather interesting, doesn't it? They were right where they were supposed to be, right? It's where God wanted them. God's grace in the famine was to ultimately help teach the brothers to seek for a better country, a heavenly one. Hebrews 11:15-16 reminds us, if they had been thinking of that land from which they had gone out, they would have had opportunity to return. But as it is, they desire a better country, that is, a heavenly one. Therefore, God is not ashamed to be called their God, for he has prepared for them a city. Friends, it can be tempting to look around at our blessings as citizens of the U.S. and become so enamored with the things of this world that we lose sight of the truth that this is not our home. For those of us who are in Christ, we are citizens of a better country, a heavenly one. So we need to be weaned from the things of this world and long for something better. Whether it's COVID or supply chain issues or rising prices for groceries or gasoline, God is allowing all of these things to remind us that there's more to life than this world has to offer. And so during this season in our lives, have we found ourselves just hanging around like Joseph's brothers? Taking in the dire situation around us but doing nothing about it? Has it caused us to sit around staring at each other and complaining? Instead, let's be encouraged to pray. Let's be encouraged to dig into the Word. Let's be encouraged to go deeper in discipleship with one another. Let's be bold and ask God, God, what do you want to teach us in this season of famine? What are you trying to do in this season of testing? Jacob wanted his boys to go down and get some relief. But he didn't want one boy to go. He wasn't quite ready for his new favorite, Benjamin, to take the trip with his brothers. If you recall, Joseph and Benjamin were the two sons of Jacob's favorite wife, Rachel, and they were held in greater esteem than the other brothers. Jacob's decision to hold Benjamin back seems to indicate he didn't really fully trust those other brothers to take care of him. While Jacob wasn't sure of what became of Joseph, he wasn't going to place this new favored child into their hands for the journey or for the potential conflict in Egypt. Who could blame them for wanting to go down and get relief? But who could blame them for sitting there and staring at each other like, what do we do now? They didn't have any direction, and so now Jacob's offering this direction, but you can't blame him for not wanting the favorite son to go with them. After all, if you think about it, Simeon and Levi committed genocide among the Shechemites. Reuben committed incest with his father's concubine in an attempt to become the patriarch of the family. Most of them were ready to kill Joseph, but settled for selling him to some passers-by who were traitors. Judah had an affair with his daughter-in-law. So clearly, this was a less than ideal bunch of men. Not exactly who you want to take care of your favorite son on a trip to Egypt. Clearly, it looks like, from our perspective, how could the promise of a restorer, how could the promise of a redeemer come from such a group of men? Yet there was grace in the famine. God placed them right where he wanted them, offering them an opportunity for a new beginning, moving them to encounter their long-lost brother so that they might know the grace of testing. Let's pick up in verse 6. Now Joseph was governor over the land. He was the one who sold to all the people of the land. Joseph's brothers came and bowed themselves before him with their faces to the ground. Joseph saw his brothers and recognized them, but he treated them like strangers and spoke roughly to them. "Where do you come from?" he said. They said, "From the land of Canaan to buy food." Joseph recognized his brothers, but they did not recognize him. That's editor's note, right? You know, he wants to make sure we get this. Joseph remembered the dreams that he dreamed of them, and he said to them, "You're spies. You've come to see the nakedness of the land." They said to him, "No, my lord, your servants have come to buy food. We're all sons of one man. We're honest men. Your servants have never been spies." He said to them, "No, it's the nakedness of the land that you've come to see." And they said, "We, your servants, are 12 brothers, the sons of one man in the land of Canaan. And behold, the youngest is this day with our father, and one is no more." Joseph said to them, "It is as I said to you. You are spies. By this you shall be tested. By the life of Pharaoh, you shall not go from this place unless your youngest brother comes here. Send one of you and let him bring your brother while you remain confined, that your words may be tested whether there is truth in you. Or else, by the life of Pharaoh, surely you are spies." He put them all together in custody for 3 days. On the third day, Joseph said to them, "Do this and you will live, for I fear God. If you're honest men, let one of your brothers remain confined where you are in custody, and let the rest go and carry grain for the famine of your households, and bring your youngest brother to me. So your words be verified, and you shall not die." And they did so. All right, so we talked about the grace of the famine. Now we're going to talk about the grace of testing. The 10 brothers have gone out on a journey. They've sought to bring relief to their desperate food problem, probably not giving any thought to encountering their long-lost brother. God, however, was working all things out so that this group of ruffians would end up seeking food from the same food storehouse where Joseph was providentially working that day. Think about it. The text says Joseph set up these storehouses around strategic cities so that the food distribution would be more closely connected to the people whom those cities serve. Municipalities do the same thing today. They put up police or EMS substations around town to better serve the community. There's even a groundswell of research going on right now considering how the neighborhood church model, instead of the megachurch model of the late 90s and first decade of 2000, is going to be how the church moves forward in the decades to come. So as governor, Joseph probably would have taken his chauffeured chariot and gone around the country doing periodic checks on how the food distribution plan was working. That's what you'd expect a governor to do. He goes around and makes sure that his subordinates are following his rules. This famine was bringing the world, it says, to Egypt. And so that meant hordes of people were streaming into town. So how could 10 guys from a foreign nation end up exactly at the storehouse where Joseph was working that day? God did it. You knew that was the answer, right? God did it. He's always working out his plan, even when we don't see it or understand it. I've said that a lot in this series. That's because Moses doesn't want us to miss this. Remember, Moses is writing to an Israelite who is post-Egypt. They've already been there, and now they're potentially wandering around in the desert. And so the Joseph narratives help the Israelites be reminded of the truth that God is still moving them where he wants them. That would be an assurance, right? If you're reading this or hearing this for the first time as an Israelite, you haven't really found settled ground anymore, and you're just wandering around, it would be encouraging to hear that God was working, even in the grace of testing, even in the grace of famine, to get his people where he wants them. The same God who led them to Egypt, led them out of Egypt, and will lead us to the promised land, is the same God who, if we will follow him, will lead us all the way home. We declared that truth in song last week. We said these words, we sang these words, "All the way my Savior leads me. What have I to ask beside? Can I doubt his tender mercy who through life has been my God? With God as guide, with God as guide, the 10 brothers bow themselves to the ground before Joseph. It's a customary practice before a high-ranking official, but this bowing down was far more significant. It was part of Joseph's dream. Now, this will happen two more times before the end of Joseph's narratives, before the end of Genesis. But he recognized that the 10 guys who were in front of him were his brothers, but they didn't recognize him. Now, there's many reasons potentially given for that, but what we do know is that Joseph saw who they were. They didn't see who he was. Maybe it was God keeping them from recognizing him, like Jesus on the road to Emmaus with the disciples. We don't know exactly, but Joseph knows who they are, and he sees it as an opportunity to take advantage over his brothers now for the first time in his life. You know, he's always been the little runt. He's always been the one they picked on. Father favored, the rest of them didn't. Now he's, I'm the governor over the land. And so he wants to test them. He wants to know for sure what's in their heart. Have they changed since the last time that he saw them? And so Joseph brilliantly comes up with this interrogation plan that gets at the information that he wants without exposing what he already knows. And so this testing mimics in many ways what the brothers did to him. They spoke harshly with him. Joseph spoke roughly with them. They accused Joseph of spying and tattling on them to their father. Now he's accusing them of being spies. The brothers threw Joseph in a pit only to bring him back up when the traitors came by. Joseph throws the brothers into prison only to bring them back up 3 days later. Well, Joseph's rough talk got the brothers sort of groveling. We're not spies. We're just here for food. We all have the same father. We're honest men. Now, wait a minute. Honest men? Really? That statement's a flat-out lie. We've seen their dishonesty repeatedly. Now, Joseph knows better. He's been on the bitter end of their deceit for over a decade. And so Joseph turns up the heat a little bit. And in the pressure of the trials, the brothers give Joseph the details he was looking for. Benjamin and Jacob are still alive. That's what he wanted to know. He wanted to know, you know, I was the favorite son. You did away with me. What happened to my full brother, Benjamin? He found out. And he wanted to know how his dad was like. Well, he hears dad's still alive. Joseph wants to know, are these brothers treating Benjamin the same way they treated me? Because if Joseph could figure that out, it would be an indication that they had changed. And the only way that that could truly come about, the only way he could really get that information is if he and Benjamin could be face to face. So Joseph drops the bomb in verse 15. Look what he says. By this you shall be tested. By the life of Pharaoh, you shall not go from this place unless your youngest brother comes here. You'll be tested. If you aren't spies, then go get this younger brother that you're talking about. I'll let one of you go and get him while the rest remain confined here with me. And then Joseph throws them into prison for 3 days to let them have some time to figure out who's going to be the one to have to make the journey home, persuade daddy to let Benjamin go, and deliver him back to Joseph. And you can imagine they're all probably mingling around in that prison cell for those 3 days. Well, not me. Oh, not me. Not me. Because they knew that their father was really clinging tightly to Benjamin, and rightfully so. But we start to see the grace of testing here. Because on the third day, Joseph brings his brothers up, and he offers them the great grace of declaring that he fears God. The brothers are probably thinking, how does this pagan Egyptian know about the God of our father? See, Joseph's knowledge of God is a great grace to them. They can rest knowing that this leader of Egypt recognizes God's authority. He fears God and knows that there's one higher and mightier than Pharaoh, king of the land, who often thought that he was God, Pharaoh. It's reasonable then for the brothers to breathe a small sigh of relief because the one who feared God should deal fairly with them. Friends, it's reasonable, too, to think that we can have fair dealings with those who fear God in our society. It's good to support businesses that aren't afraid to champion the ways of God. But there's also a caution. If we publicly promote the things of God in our business, we need to do that in every transaction so as not to defame the God we claim to serve. If we proudly display "In God We Trust" on our license plate, or we have some artistically designed scripture written all over our rear window, it's reasonable for the world to think that we fear God. So let's be sure to drive that way. At the end of 3 days, Joseph's fear of God meant that he experienced a change of heart as well. Out of grace, did you notice? He changed the plan. Only one man needed to stay so that the rest could take all these abundant provisions back to the family. Joseph knew how many people were there. He probably didn't know all of how many, but he knew at least most of who was there. And so God's grace in this testing all of a sudden changes Joseph's heart too. And yet his change here was also a test. Would the brothers simply take the provisions and run, leaving behind one brother just like they did to him? See, this is a test too. That's what they did to him. Took the money and ran. The grace of testing, though, meant they were presented with an opportunity for repentance. Look at verse 21. Then they said to one another, "In truth," now they're starting to be honest men, right? "In truth." It's like when somebody says, "Let me tell you the truth. We are guilty concerning our brother, and that we saw the distress of his soul when he begged us and we did not listen. That is why this distress has come upon us." And Reuben answered them, "Did I not tell you not to sin against the boy? But you didn't listen. So now there comes a reckoning for his blood." They did not know that Joseph understood them, for there was an interpreter between them. Then he turned away from them and wept. And he returned to them and spoke to them, and he took Simeon from them and bound him before their eyes. You know where the grace is? The grace came in the form of guilt. The grace came in the form of blood guilt. They knew they were guilty, and they deserved death. Genesis chapter 9, verse 6, might have been ringing loudly in their heads, which says, "Whoever sheds the blood of man, by man shall his blood be shed, for God made man in his own image." Secular scholars, Freudians, see guilt as merely a safety device that's meant to protect civilized order. They largely dismiss it. But godly guilt is a grace because it can lead the guilty to seek forgiveness and repent. Notice the brothers have changed a little bit, even in their language. They once called Joseph the dreamer. Now they call him our brother, Reuben, even giving him that affectionate term, the boy. That actually is affectionate. Consider Reuben saying this. 2 Corinthians 7:10 says, "For godly grief produces a repentance that leads to salvation without regret, whereas worldly grief produces death." Maybe God's word is doing the work of revealing of sin in our own hearts. May we acknowledge that guilt and allow it to be a prelude to grace. God's love for us means his grace can set us free from the guilt of the past, no matter what we've done, no matter how long we've done it. If you're here today and haven't placed your confidence in Christ, if you've yet to receive his grace, it's not too late. Just as God brought those brothers to appear before Joseph as a great grace, he's brought you here today to be confronted by his word and find great grace that is sufficient for you and for me. Now, as the brothers are recounting their story to Joseph, they have no idea he could understand what they were saying. And so in order not to blow his cover, he turns around and goes into a separate room and weeps. He had a tender compassion for his brothers, but the test wasn't complete, so he pressed on. The tender compassion is an example of God's great tender compassion toward repentant sinners. Church, may we show that same compassion for those who have wronged us. The flesh often says, "Make them pay." The gospel says Jesus has already paid. Now, before we leave this grace of testing, Scripture teaches that God tests his people. God does test his people. But the tests are not for God's sake. It's not as if God needs to see what we're going to do in order to make his next move. The tests are actually for our sake. It's allowing our commitment to him to be tried in order to show that we are truly his people. Passing the test shows us that we do strive to live for him. The grace of testing is God's gift to us because in persevering through them, we have further assurance of our salvation. So the next time, notice I said the next time, not if, but the next time we encounter a time of testing, let's challenge one another to see it as a gift of grace that's meant to bolster our faith. For Joseph, persevering meant an assurance that his brothers had changed. Doing so meant an opportunity to see the grace of blessing. Look at verse 25 and following. And Joseph gave orders to fill their bags with grain and to replace every man's money in his sack and to give them provisions for the journey. This was done for them. Then they loaded their donkeys with their grain and departed, and as one of them opened his sack to give his donkey fodder at the lodging place, he saw his money in the mouth of his sack. He said to his brothers, "My money's been put back. Here it is in the mouth of my sack." At this, their hearts failed them, and they turned trembling to one another, saying, "What is this that God has done to us?" When they came to Jacob, their father, in the land of Canaan, they told him all about that had happened to them, saying, The Lord of the land spoke roughly to us, took us to be spies of the land. But we said to him, "We're honest men. We've never been spies. We're 12 brothers, sons of our father. One is no more, and the youngest is this day with our father in the land of Canaan." Then the man, the Lord of the land, said to us, "By this I shall know that you were honest men. Leave one of your brothers with me, and take grain for the famine of your households, and go your way. Bring your youngest brother to me, then I shall know that you're not spies, but honest men. And I will deliver your brother to you, and you shall trade in the land." As they emptied their sacks, behold, every man's bundle of money was in his sack. And when they and their father saw their bundles of money, they were afraid. And Jacob, their father, said to them, "You bereaved me of my children. Joseph's no more, Simeon's no more, and now you would take Benjamin? All this has come against me." Then Reuben said to his father, "Kill my two sons if I don't bring them back to you. Put him in my hands. I'll bring him back to you." But he said, "My son shall not go down with you, for his brother is dead, and he's the only one left." That probably was a little sting, don't you think? He's staring at his other sons as he's saying this. "If harm should happen to him on the journey that you are to make, you bring down my gray hairs with sorrow to Sheol." Joseph was quick to fill their sacks with all they needed for their journey and their family back home. Twice, however, the blessing or the grace of this blessing in abundance seemed to be a great concern to the brothers and to Jacob. To the brothers, the concern probably had to do with the fear that they might be charged with not only being spies, but also thieves. You know, so they open their sacks. They're just at the lodging place. They're not that far away. What if the officials look and they see that the money's gone and they chase after them? That's a reason to fear, right? For Jacob, the problem was his sons had gone. They probably stirred up trouble in his mind. They went to Egypt. They caused a mess. They got all this money, and now they're coming to get us. They're going to destroy us here in the land. Both the brothers and Jacob, they're concerned. The grace of blessing wasn't a blessing at this point. And it was all too much for Jacob. He made it clear he was not going to release Benjamin into their care. In his mind, the heartache these boys have caused meant he now lost two sons and he wasn't going to lose his new favorite now. Reuben steps up. Reuben's the firstborn. He hasn't always been a man of integrity, but he steps up to assert some leadership, right? He says, "Look, you can have my two sons and kill them if I don't bring them back." But it does leave us asking the question, does this mean that Reuben is now going to assume his role as the firstborn and solve this dilemma? Well, we'll have to wait until next week to see about that. But here's the grace and the blessing. Look back at verse 28. They said, Psalm 28. He said to his brothers, "My money's been put back. Here it is in the mouth of my sack." At this, their hearts failed them, and they turned trembling to one another, saying, "What is this that God has done to us?" That's the first time the brothers mention the Lord. This blessing allowed them to see the work of God behind the frightful circumstances. And so this blessing moved them to godly fear. John Newton wrote in his famous hymn, "'Twas grace that taught my heart to what? Fear. Not fear like watching a scary movie, not fear like going to Scarewinds or Haunted Trails in Gastonia, not like that. It's fear that says, look, it's helping the brothers realize that God was afflicting them and he was the only source that could offer forgiveness and help. Joseph's blessing was misunderstood by his family. Have you ever found yourself trying to bless someone only to have them misunderstand your kindness? Let's not allow that to keep us from being a blessing to others. Let's continue to excel at being a blessing by giving beyond the bare minimum expected in all things, time, talents, resources, and finances. When I worked at Chick-fil-A, we were ingrained in second mile service. In other words, we were expected to go the second mile with our guests. May we be those who practice the grace of blessing. Well, by this point, Jacob has heard enough. He discouragingly says, all this has come against me. But what he thought was against him, God was working for good. Grace in the famine, grace in the testing, grace in the blessing. No wonder we sing about God's amazing grace. Grace that's freely offered by a God who is sovereign over every bit of our lives. God, I pray that you would take your word now and show us how to walk out these truths in our own lives. Maybe we know someone right now who's in a period of testing. Then may we take the words of this narrative and use it to encourage them, recognizing that you are still at work, helping them see that. Maybe there's someone in our lives who's struggling financially, emotionally, physically, and we can offer them the grace of blessing today. Give us courage to do that. May we excel at that grace, as Paul says. And God, when our famine comes, may we see the grace in it and recognize your sovereign goodness to us. That we might walk out of those doors changed because of your grace. We pray this in the name of Jesus. Amen. Church family, would you stand as we consider the text? And sing the words to sovereign over us. Appropriate song to finish out what we're talking about in Genesis 42. God working all things out for his goodness. If you'd like someone to pray with you, I'd be honored to do that. I'll be out front, something going on in your life. Just want someone to pray with you. I'd be honored. Others in this room would be honored to do that. You say today, you know, I'm in a period of testing. You say, today I'm in a period of famine. Maybe it's a famine for knowing the truth about what Christ did for you in your life. I'd love to tell you about what a relationship with Christ means. Let's declare these words to be true. Be sovereign over us.
There's strength within the sorrow. There's beauty in our tears. When you meet us in mourning, with the love that casts out fear, you're working in our way. Sanctifying us when beyond our understanding teaching us to trust. Your plans are still to prosper. You have not forgotten us. You're with us in the fire and the blood. You're faithful forever, perfect in love. You are sovereign over us. Your wisdom are imagined. Understand your ways, reigning high above the heavens, reaching down in endless grace. You're the lifter of the lowly, compassionate and kind. Surround and you uphold me. Your promises are mighty light. Your plans are still to prosper. You have not forgotten us. You're with us in the fire and the
working for our good.
praise him alone. Let's be reminded of what we need to do in our response, recognizing his sovereignty over us. Read these words of benediction with me. If possible,
so far as it depends on you,
live peacefully with all.
Beloved, never avenge yourselves, but leave it to the wrath of God. For it is written, vengeance is mine, I will repay, says the Lord. To the contrary, if your enemy is hungry, feed him. If he is thirsty, give him something to drink, for by so doing you will heap burning coals on his head. Do not be overcome by evil, but overcome evil with good. Love, serve, and go. You're dismissed.